As a post-war student of art, music, and film, Tarkovsky was well ensconced in the official state art of Soviet realism. So it's no surprise that he felt an affinity and kinship with Italian neorealism. His classmate, Sasha Gordon, said, "We were crazy about Italian neorealism, and for good reason. To us, it was a revelation, really revolutionary. It was nothing like our bland movies." But Andre took a strange position. He said that neorealism was outdated. Something new was needed. Something else had to be found. When Tarkovsky was offered to take over the troubled production of Vladimir Bogomolov's Ivan of Odestova, the tragic story of a wartime orphan, Tarkovsky said he felt the realism was too restraining, describing the script as almost in the tone of a report. An aesthetic Dvoeverie was beginning to strive within Tarkovsky, that bitter longing to see the two schools, the real and the symbolic, as one. He sleeps on it and hits upon his tactic, the war child dreams of being a child. Watching the film, one might sense an overcompensation of that impatient temper, as any 28-year-old making their first feature so eager to show his facility with cinematic conventions, often lapsing into mere expressionistic decoupage. But more critically, it's actually the enthusiasm of an impatient temper in natural aesthetic progression. It won the Golden Lion at the Venice Film Festival in 1962, to the dismay of the Italian left. It was a transgression to neorealism for the critics in the Italian Communist Party journal, L'Unité. Dreams, we in the West stopped using dreams long ago. Tarkovsky's slow in the uptake. Those were all right between the wars. Jean-Paul Sartre himself quickly rose to Tarkovsky's defense in a letter to the editor of L'Unité. Sartre argues that Ivan's imagination is his reality. We continue to see Ivan from the outside, just as in the realistic scenes. The truth is, the whole world is a hallucination for this child. This is not a question of expressionism or symbolism, but a narrative method demanded by the subject itself, and what the young poet Voznesensky called socialist surrealism.
Прав. Мне кажется, что был прав Моравия все-таки, когда он критиковал мою картину. Что касается Сартра, который меня защищал, он меня защищал со слишком таких, я бы сказал, философских позиций.
Indeed, nothing that Sartre said so accurately describes Tarkovsky's oeuvre as Alberto Moravia's observation that it is what we are forced to do that forms our character, not what we do of our own free will. This observation aptly describes the developmental role of Pascagne in the naturalist-realist temper. In his second film, The Passion of Andrei Rublev, Tarkovsky said he wanted the sense of fresh leaves opening up. His depiction of Rublev's attunement exemplifies Aristotle's concept of Pascagne. Rublev is all subject, open to the world without guile or judgment. Curiously, this emphasis on Rublev's aesthetic disposition casts him as a kind of monastic impostor, innocently for sure, but the monastic ideologies and dogmas mean less to him than his sense of community. The sensual custody of the monk's life gnaws at us as we watch him claw the table in frustrated inarticulation of his sincere brotherly love. But Rublev's innocence also borders on comedy when he chances upon the pagan fertility rite of Kupala. Rublev chases after them like a naive Pentheus, eager to see the revelry. The comedy dissipates quickly when he is discovered and his life threatened by the pagans. Consequently, he hits a wall when he is commissioned to paint the wrath of God on Judgment Day. Rublev's non-judgmental instincts delay the job, so his assistants take on the commission of another chapel in a nearby village, unaware of the local political intrigue, that it is in fact the rival project of their previous employer's evil brother. The monks fan the flames of old grudges between the two lords, and the artists pay dearly. Retaliations escalate until one of the brothers convinces a tribe of Tartars to help him raid and decimate his brother's village. The realism that Tarkovsky presses upon this sequence is barely palatable. Stunts and actual animal cruelty become indistinguishable, and the result is spectacular to the point of repulsion. Since the catastrophe is due to his very own good intentions, the weight of guilt falls squarely on Rublev's shoulders. Traumatized, Rublev withdraws completely into the simple, cloistered life. Here, Tarkovsky reveals Christianity's secret inner Dvoeverie, the theodicy problem. How can one believe in an all-powerful and good creator whose creation is monstrously cruel? There is considerable irony in this Christian Dvoeverie. By refusing the pagan view of nature and time as cyclic and eternal, nature's sense of immortality is lost, while Christianity prides itself with a mystery at the core of its theology. Years pass, and the aged Rublev one day encounters a young boy at the command of a new civic project. Like Walter Benjamin's destructive man, the boy makes his way ruthlessly. In a wild frenzy of childish power rants and tantrums, he terrorizes his assistants. When the day arrives to raise the bell, the boy realizes his vulnerability. His swagger is gone. He is faced with the truth that his only talent was lying. He actually knew nothing about bell casting. If the bell is a dud, he is dead. The bell emerges from him inexplicably, leaving the boy morally exhausted. The final scene is simple yet remarkably complex, despite or perhaps because of its rather overt symbolic statement about the irreducible dynamics of Pasquin's quiet and Poyain's violence. But even having its literariness made explicit, the natural human drama of the image endures with its own life. One would think the immediate presence of a photographic image could directly deploy the natural dynamic of an image. But Tarkovsky faced the very same problem as Joyce and Pound, that human reflex to reduce things to simplified, cognitive, ideal moments of thought. What Tarkovsky discovered in The Passion of Andrei Rublev, perhaps in this very shot, is that because film is a time-sustained image, film has the ability to force the gaze beyond logical necessity, leaving you alone with the image and your imagination. If there are things in the world that persist apart from the contest of human intention, this decaying image is our last chance for us to see for ourselves. In the end, The Passion of Andrei Rublev was criticized for too much naturalism.